Father, I will send your Holy Spirit upon us. As that same Holy Spirit overshadowed your servant, she conceived your only begotten Son and gave birth to him. Allow that holy word of yours to give forth fruit in our lives. And like Mary, we bring that good news to others as she carried her Son, the Lord Jesus, to her cousin Elizabeth. We ask this through Christ our Lord. We have a few of it this evening, but Christmas is coming. Christmas is coming. Perhaps not spend so much time in the lectio this evening and have an opportunity for questions or comments in general. Okay. But we'll read the text first of all. And like last week, the text in the liturgy missed out a rather important part of Mary's Magnificat. I haven't done these notes. This is from the Carmelite website, ocarm.org. It's an excellent website with commentary on all readings, both of Sundays and weekdays. So, ocarm.org.
Ocarm.
Carmelite, as in Carmelite. ocarm.org. And it says here, as you read the text, let's try and pay attention to the following. What gestures, words, and comparisons made by Mary and Elizabeth express the discovery of God's presence in their life? So we're down to the bottom of the page, and I will start with you. Okay.
Mary set out at that time and went as quickly as she could into the hill country to a town in Judah.
She went to Zachariah's house and greeted Elizabeth.
Now it happened that as soon as Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit.
She gave a loud cry and said, "Of all women, you are the most blessed, and blessed is the fruit of your womb.
Why should I be honoured with a visit from the mother of my Lord?
Look, the moment your greeting reached my ears, the child in my womb leapt for joy.
Yes, blessed is she who believes that the promise made her by the Lord will be fulfilled."
And Mary said, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord.
And my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour.
Because he has looked upon the humiliation of his servant, yes, from now onwards all generations will call me blessed.
For the Almighty has done great things for me. Holy is his name.
And his faithful love extends age after age to those who fear him.
He has used the power of his arm. He has rooted the arrogant of heart, routed the arrogant of heart.
He has pulled down princes from their thrones and raised high the lowly.
He has filled the starving with good things, sent the rich away empty.
He has come to the help of Israel his servant, mindful of his faithful love.
According to the promise he made to our ancestors, of his mercy to Abraham and to his descendants forever."
Mary stayed with her some 3 months and then went home.
We'll just have a moment of prayer for silence. At this point, we'll choose a word or a couple of words which have caught our attention, which means something to us. Okay, perhaps we'd like to share that word or words which we focused in upon. Little episode from the Gospel. Luke loves to compare and contrast. Now we're talking about, there's a lovely comparison or contrast between John the Baptist and Jesus. You know, through the first two chapters, you see what happens to John, what happens to Jesus. But then Jesus goes further. So John leaps in the womb when Mary greets his mother. Another contrast going on here between Mary and Elizabeth. Elizabeth is very much an Old Testament figure. You've got Elizabeth and Zachariah. I'm just reading that. We're still in the pages of the Old Testament. Mary is the New Testament. Mary is very much the New Testament. But still rooted in the Old. And see that whole Magnificat? That could be an Old Testament psalm. You know? Notice there's no Christology there. What do you mean by that? She's not talking about what Christ will accomplish through his death and resurrection. It's what God, the Old Testament God, has done. In fact, I think it's in the book of Ruth. You get a very similar hymn like that. So Luke again is mining the Old Testament. This is not to say that Mary didn't say this, of course. We don't know, but content. It only appears in Luke's Gospel, of course, the Magnificat. But the Old Testament has been mined for this hymn. And so we're at the cusp of the Old Testament and the New Testament. You've got Elizabeth and Zachariah, straight from the Old Testament, no question about it. Mary, who, yes, is very much embedded in the Old Testament, and yet she's ushering in something new, the new which will begin with her son. So another lovely comparison of this, you know, a bit like Jesus and John the Baptist, they're very similar, but one is doing something new. One is more powerful, so to speak. You know, Mary's, through her son, is ushering in this new period in God's plan of salvation. And I said last time as well that with Luke we get the first attempt to contemplate Mary's role in God's plan of salvation. And Mary is presented very much in Luke's Gospel as a model and example of Christian discipleship. We don't have anything in Paul at all. Remember, Paul is the person who first wrote New Testament documents. The only reference to Mary, and this might come as a shock to us as Catholics, the only reference to Mary by Paul is very indirect. It's Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, when Paul is trying to emphasise the humanity of Jesus. He says he was born under the law, born of a woman. That's the only reference Paul makes to Mary. That's a strong, isn't it? Because he hadn't reflected on it at that point. The issue just hadn't arisen for Paul. You know, what's Mary's role in all this? Similarly with Mark, the first of the Gospels generally accepted. Mark has no infancy gospel. If we only had the Gospel of Mark, then we would know absolutely nothing about the events surrounding the birth of Jesus. And Mary appears in Mark's Gospel, but if she appears at all, it's in a rather negative light. That we're told that Jesus was surrounded by a crowd, he was in a house, and someone said, "Your mother and brother and sisters are outside looking for you." And he says, "Who are my brothers? These are my brothers. Those who hear the word of God and keep are my brothers." So Mark doesn't have any kind of Marian reflection. With Luke, that changes. And we have Mary then at the very beginning of the Gospel, and there's a whole treasure there to develop about our understanding of Mary. And just in that little phrase, that little encounter about your mother's outside calling for you, and Jesus said, "Who is my mother?" Luke changes that and says, "Who is my mother and brother and sister? My mother is the one who hears God's word and keeps it." See how he changes that? So he's given Mary as an example and model of Christian living. And then Matthew doesn't really have much about Mary. With John, John goes in a quite different direction, more profound level, if you want. His whole gospel is bracketed but two episodes of Our Blessed Lady, the marriage feast of Cana, and then the foot of the cross, where he said to the beloved disciple, behold your mother, behold your son. And these are highly symbolic events, of course. So John presents Mary very much as a figure of the church. And I think as a consequence to that, there's an ecumenical consequence, but Janice being here is quite interesting, you know, to say this, that we can look to other churches for whom Mary doesn't have a great importance. You know, there's no great Marian devotion in some Christian churches. Now we can either, you can then conclude from that, well, we're right and they're wrong, as has been done in the past, you know. Or we can go back to the New Testament and see that the communities behind each gospel and each letter, they are living Christian churches. And they had, you know, a Christian life, an understanding of God, of Christ, of the Spirit, and it didn't have any Marian doctrine or Marian spirituality. So churches from the very beginning, evident from the New Testament, didn't feel the need to have a Marian spirituality. Other churches did, already evidenced by the New Testament. And we as Catholics, of course, then have that Marian spirituality, which is really foundational, I think, for Catholic faith as well. As long as then you don't exaggerate it, as it has been done in the past. Do you see that point I'm trying to make? You know, that for ecumenical dialogue, returning to the sources can actually be extremely helpful, because then we discover, well, there were churches, for instance, that existed that didn't really, maybe they didn't have bishops that we have, you know, then you look at other documents for whom, for those churches, the bishops would be quite important, and the structure would be very important, sort of thing. So, for instance, letters to Timothy and Titus, we see that triple structure of bishop, priest, and deacon already embedded in the Christian experience. If we go earlier to Mark's Gospel, you know, it's not really evident as we look between the lines, because what we have to remember, we can look read between the lines of a Gospel. The Gospel is telling us about the life of Jesus, absolutely. But it's written for a specific community with their own questions, difficulties and aspirations. And so we can get an idea of the community for which the document was written by a careful examination of that. So for instance, in Luke's Gospel then, we can see this rather urban community, reasonably well off, quite urbane, and it's a community which is grappling with the need for mercy. For whatever reason, we can see that was a community need, that they felt mercy was extremely important. Whether it was mercy they had to show to others from perhaps their own goods, or mercy they had received, they could have been, for instance, freed slaves. But mercy was a very important thing for them. So Luke digs that into his Gospel, and then sees Mary as a figure of mercy, or as an ideal disciple. And he's saying, well, if we really want to stay close to Christ, look at his mother. Look at the person she was. And she gives us a good model for what it is to be Christian. And then I think the last point that I've made of the New Testament in general is to see that from the word go, there's a development going on. That these weren't books dropped from an eye, okay? At the risk of sounding unecumenical, we are not Islam, you know, that's really important. You know, their notion of revelation was the angel Gabriel dictated the whole thing to the prophet, word for word. And that leads me to a cul-de-sac today, because that word is dictated by God himself. You can't change it. You can't change it. Now, we believe, yes, the Bible is the word of God, it's revelation, inspired under the direction of the Holy Spirit. But we also believe it's a human word, and that's very important. So it's not, doesn't arrive by TNT or whatever, straight from heaven, you know, already formed. Rather, it's a product of human understanding as much as, again, here's God as the totally other one, respecting us as finite creatures. He's giving us his revelation, and we are writing that, the writers are putting that down in writing, as far as they understood it, as far as they understood it. And that's why in the Old Testament, you'll get passages which can be quite hair-raising, for instance. But less so in the New. That's really interesting. Less so in the New. That the figure of Jesus of Nazareth seems to have been so powerful that a lot of the, if you want, the darker side of human nature just disappeared. But the darker side of human nature is there in the Old Testament. You know, vengeance upon my enemies and all that. So there's a development going on right through the entire Bible, but also in the New Testament we can see what we would call doctrine, let's say the Trinity, already developing and changing and going deeper. And that's just respecting the sacred books as for what they are, the Word of God in human words. And just returning to the Old Testament, you know, when we get those kind of blood-curdling things, like God smiting the foes of Israel. And you see, especially in the Psalms, that the psalmist would start off quite well, blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, or whatever. And now, see those foes, would you ever go and smite them? <on this? laughs> And the way I read those passages like that is to see them very much as human expressions. This is the human very often transposing his, generally his, I suspect, his feelings onto God. So even in the Bible, we have the molten calf, you know, when the people get fed up and Moses is up the mountain, and they say, this God we can't see, you know, can't be bothered with that. We want to see something, you know, and so they make the image of the bull. And it's a bit like that even with the words they choose, with the words they choose in the Bible, that they are being expressed by individuals who are restricted culturally, historically, individually, psychologically, the Lord. And very often they are putting onto God their own angst, if you want. So there's a psalm we say in the Believer every morning, it ends off God saying, never shall they enter my rest. You know, and it's quite stark. And what that is a human person, it could be a couple of things. A human person saying, I'll never enter your rest. You know, I'm so far from it. And that's put to the word of God. So we condemn ourselves almost, you know. Or else it's that the writer is so fed up with lack of progress among the people, nothing seems to be happening. And so God saying, never, all the end of my rest. And then those feelings, all those kind of negative feelings and negative images of God are suddenly turned into something quite beautiful, you know. But it's a human heart and a human person that is writing this. Even though we believe it's under divine inspiration, the Spirit uses even the darker sides of a human person in some way for progress in the spiritual journey. Okay.
Can I just ask you, Father, when we have the daily psalm, any given day, and you see that a particular verse is on any given day, because a lot of the verses that are taken out are very often these horrible negative ones, aren't they? Probably not necessarily a lot of horrible, but is there a reason, or was that St. Jerome, or was it the church that actually...
No, it's the church that's done that. That's right. And I think that is dangerous. The other thing that these violent psalms, or the violent part of the Old Testament, they're taking seriously the violence of the human person. Mm-hmm. It's not being body swept at all. The violence inherent in the human person is right there in the pages of the Old Testament. often attributed to God, of course. So it's right there. And we can see in the Psalms, no question about that. I remember hearing about an American community of nuns who are very uncomfortable with these Psalms, with the violent language. That they got a group of, I think, Jesuits or something, scholars of some sort, to go through all the Psalms that they say on a daily, weekly basis, and to take out every violent thing from them, every violent word. You know, this must have been the 60s or 70s when everyone was right on. So violence then was, what's the right word? It was censored.
Sanitized.
And what they were doing there was their own particular historical cultural situation, say in the east or the west coast of the United States in the 1970s, were creating something quite new. It wasn't the psalmist or the Bible, but they were creating a new document. And they'd say, we don't want any violent words in this document. That's fine if they want to do that, but it's not the Bible. Whatever we're creating is not the Bible. And so the Bible, especially the Old Testament, is really a challenge for us to look at the violence in ourselves, in the world, elsewhere, and see that, you know, how do I deal with that? How do I deal with that? The psalmist, I think one of the things that the psalmist is doing is, he's dealing with it by voicing it, and by voicing it to God, and that could be, you know, quite a good way forward to sort of thing, so the violence doesn't build up in the system. And I think I mentioned recently, maybe one of the seven, I can't remember, this French theologian just died recently, and he sees the sacrifice of the Mass as being that, very much as our way to participate in once and for all sacrifice of Christ, our access to the great sacrifice of Christ. He sees the violence and the bloodiness of it as a way to, for the human person, humankind, to empty their violence onto Christ. It's quite a powerful reading of the Mass, actually, and I think I can see where he's coming from. That Paul talks of Christ becoming a curse, and he uses very strong language, or Christ becoming sin itself. So the Christ on the cross is soaks up all the violence of the world as he hangs on the cross. That's why the cross had to be bloody. You know, why the cross? Because of the violence of human nature. So that the Christ, the Son of God, then is taking this, the whole of the violence of humankind, to say there is another way forward. That, of course, violence still exists, but it doesn't have the power over us. There is another way forward. Not by our own efforts, that's the mistake we made, not by our own efforts, but only through God's intervention, only through the power of the Spirit, can we overcome the violence of humankind, and it's made possible by Christ's sacrifice on the cross. So it's quite a powerful reading of the Mass, and that means that the Mass then is yes, rooted in history, as Christ's sacrifice is rooted in history, but it goes beyond history. So at Mass then, what we believe, that we gain access to Christ's once and for all sacrifice on the cross. It's as though that sacrifice is there, and at the same time we anticipate the eternal banquet of heaven at the second coming. So the first and second coming have been held at the Mass. And finally, I think once we start thinking along those lines, seeing Christ on the cross as the historical event, as is the resurrection, but also beyond time, then that means when we pray for Christ's second coming, he has already arrived. Think, for instance, of the resurrection of Jesus, okay? We pray for the eternal rest of our dear ones. And so people die, okay? And they go to heaven, we say. Okay, that's fine. But we also talk of the last judgment. And so also there's a period between your personal death and the time Christ will come again. So what's going on there? If we see Christ's resurrection as beyond time, rooted in time, but beyond time, Christ's resurrection from the dead is my resurrection, is your resurrection, is the resurrection of all the dear ones who have gone before us. That is the second coming. It's beyond time. So there's no in-between time, so to speak. My personal death is when I participate fully in the second coming of Christ and in his historical resurrection. If that doesn't sound too zany completely, it's to get beyond the categories of time and space. And that's what's happening at Mass. We are participating in the reality of Christ's Paschal mystery, suffering, death and resurrection, and we're getting a real taste. We participate already in the heavenly banquet. That's what we really believe, because it's beyond time. And also it's because it's cosmic. It's not just affecting this world. We believe the whole cosmos is redeemed. And at Mass, the Mass itself becomes this cosmic act in which we're thanking God for the whole of creation. That's something to think of for the last 2 days of Advent. I know it's a bit heavy, some of that stuff, but it's, you know, the Gospels, they kind of pushes in directions, and the more you come back to stuff, then the more suddenly things start striking you, sort of thing.
I think what Louis said, it's heavy. The more you, how do you put this simple? For what we've been fed and told and shown and explained to us over the years, we don't necessarily, speaking personally, have the time or the enthusiasm or the knowledge or the ability to get always behind it and try and understand what's there. It's the coded messages, it's the hidden messages that we get in the Bible, in the New Testament, in the readings, but we, through whatever reason, don't spend enough time researching, understanding and trying to play a fuller part in it. Although you're saying it's heavy, I could probably have sat here till midnight and still not think it's heavy. There's a lot to try and get beyond and understand. And I think that's one of the biggest things that I've thought of these last 4 weeks. It's just hearing a different way of saying something that's making me think, hey, I never thought of that connection before. I think what Estelle said there about taking bits of the Psalms and taking the bad bits of the Psalms out and the smiting and the flooding and all this. The worst thing we could possibly ever contemplate is the nails going in. And yet, I've never made that connection.
The ultimate violence.
That's, yes. I've been angry with the smiting and the flooding. But I've never really thought of how violent that is to how violent the crucifixion was. So, thank you. It's a good way of explaining and getting it interesting.
Yeah. And also, you know, that just that way we've been reading the scriptures, I find that fruitful. You know, just home in a word or two words, see where it takes you. See where it takes you. And I often find that it's a good way to stay calm down, settle down into prayer. You know, use it as a wee mantra so that we're going beyond words. You know, that set prayers are, you know, important. You know, the prayers that you use, prayer cards and all that sort of stuff. Words are important because we're human beings. But so is that, you know, getting into that kind of deep silence insofar as we can. It might only last like a couple of seconds. But then through good habit, through practice, you'll find that that happens more and more, and you know, then strange things, good things happen. At least you come out here and say, well, that was good. Which is nice to see after prayer.
I'm just on another part of why you encourage the congregation after communion, or even after the sermon and that, to actually have that quiet moment.
Yes, I don't think I've actually explained that at Sunday Mass, but that's, you know, I do a short period of silence after the readings, mm-hmm. and then after Holy Communion, that's the idea. Mm-hmm. That we're encouraged to have a period of silence during Mass. Mm-hmm. And also, a couple of folk brought it up, when I'm offering up the gifts of bread and wine, I say that silently. Mm-hmm. It's still not a silent period in the Mass. Give me a rest as well. But that's the insight, you know, that you know, if the Mass is just words tumbling after each other, it can become a bit kind of, you know, too much. So we're encouraged to have periods of silence. So I do that after readings, after Holy Communion. And then that wee period in the middle of the offerings, what the rubrics say, segrete, that's the Latin. And you'll sometimes hear some priest mumbling it. I don't have some priest will hear it. It's a very kind of sort of voce. But really it means it's silent or it's allowed, or sort of thing. I don't quite get the kind of whispering of this sort of thing. Yeah. Silence.
Might just be worth explaining that.
It should be, it should be.
They're thinking of maybe sleep.
Yeah, yes. He's missed a bit.
When's the next bit start?
At some point, I would like to give some sort of catechesis in the Mass.
Yes.
Just, you know, at the end of Mass, each week for a period of week, just short new things, and then build that up hopefully into a weekend booklet or something.
No, we'll try to get you to do more work.
No, but that, I recognise that. Because people that try, you know, but people did have approached me and said, how do you say that? That's right.
You must sometimes just see bulbs going on in people's eyes, you know, and say, oh, that's what that meant.
That's what happened, exactly. That's right. Okay, let's end up with the glory. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, and ever shall be, one and the end.
Amen. May God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful Christmas, and will we continue it in life?
Absolutely.
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Brian.